gentlemen, I give you Campbell Brown and Linda McMahon.
And let me echo the welcome from Dean Shalitoff and thank all of you for coming and taking time today to be part of this great conversation. Campbell and I are good friends, and I'm thrilled that you would take time to come out and be with us today. But let me just show you a little bit about Campbell, since we are in this great facility. I think we definitely need a little video introduction as well. So Ryan and I would like to thank Ryan and his group for the editing that was done for this kind of very last minute. They really put together a nice piece, which you will see.
Campbell Brown is in Baghdad this morning.
I'm Campbell Brown, live this morning in New Orleans. Seeing all this from up here, from this vantage point, I feel overwhelmed. He takes me by the hand for a tour of this heartbreaking place. Why didn't you do anything? You're the mayor of this city. Don't you bear some of the responsibility for what's happening? Day two of high political drama. I believe that journalists do have a crucial role to play in challenging our leaders, no matter what their political persuasion. So I get asked a lot, are you an advocate now, or are you a journalist?
And I'm here today with Campbell Brown, former CNN host and now an education reformer. Thanks for joining me.
Good to be here. It says in our credibility that when there's a clear moral issue at stake, we should speak out about it, especially when it involves children. Best education for our kids. That is the goal, because a child's hopes and dreams will never be ours to compromise away. This is a cause that deserves everything we can give it, and that's why I'm all in, and I hope you will be too. Wow. I'm having total flashbacks right now, because not only did I haven't seen all that in a very long time, but Joe Alicastro is a long, long time former colleague of mine. And so just when I saw Joe's face, I almost fell off my chair. This is a little bizarre. I'm back in NBC world right now. Okay, I'll snap out of it.
Well, at NBC, weren't you the White House correspondent?
I was for a few years. That was probably the most interesting time I had as a journalist. I loved the time I was there. It was fascinating to me.
So I understand, Campbell, you actually got into journalism because you were just a trouble kid in high school and you kept being kind of a little bit of a rabble rouser. So tell us about that a little bit.
I tell this story. I grew up in the South. My parents divorced, so I was mostly raised by my mother. I had two sisters, and my mother was sort of a latent feminist. She was kind of this very traditional person living in the South in this patriarchal society, and she was intent on raising women to be the opposite of who she was. So she would always tell us when we were kids that I'll never forget this, we were under no obligation to show respect for authority unless they had earned it. So I was told that from a very young age, which meant if my teacher said something that I didn't think was true, I challenged them in second grade and third grade, and I was sent to the principal's office all the time. And I say this all the time, had I not found journalism, which is really the one profession that rewards that sort of behavior, I would have been in serious trouble. But fortunately I did. Where, as a journalist, when you are annoying, challenging, asking questions, you get paid for it. So it was a gift. Yes, finding
journalism. But you didn't start out at the top of the pay scale. What was your first salary?
No, my first job was at a local station in Topeka, Kansas, and I had never even been there. And I had interned at some TV stations. I was living in Washington, D.C. And I had taken unpaid internships, and I so wanted a job. I had, at the time, you made a VCR, a little videotape of your stories that you would send around, that was your resume, basically. And I sent this videotape out to 200 stations around the country, in small towns all over the place. And the one station that called me back was in Topeka, Kansas, and having never been there, they flew me out for an interview, and they offered me the job, and it was $6 an hour. And I remember driving back to the airport and passing a Pizza Hut, and there was a big sign up at the Pizza Hut that said, delivery drivers, $15 an hour. I was like, whoa, I just took a job that pays half of that, less than half of that. And I said yes. I packed up my stuff, and I went to Topeka. And then from Topeka, I got a job from there in Richmond, Virginia, and then Baltimore, and then Washington, D.C., and then the NBC affiliate services, which did local stories for the NBC affiliates, and then MSNBC in its original version, and then finally NBC News.
And then when you left NBC?
I was at NBC News for 11 years, and so I keep looking at Joe, but it was really family for me, because it's a long time to be in one place, and that's where I feel like I grew up. I had great colleagues. Tim Russert was my boss in the Washington Bureau, obviously a great, great man who is so dearly missed. Just Tom Brokaw was an incredible mentor to all of us when we were, learning the ropes, so to speak. I won't name names, but when I was at the White House, the president would have when he gave the State of the Union, they would invite the evening news anchors the day of the State of the Union, and the president would sort of walk them through what he was going to say. And I was White House correspondent with David Gregory, and we shared this tiny little office in the press room. And the evening news anchors would leave that meeting with the White House, and they would go on TV and talk about what they'd learned, except for Tom. Tom would come down to the office in the White House press room, and he'd tell David and I everything that the president had told him so that we could go on the air and get all the credit for it. It was a very generous thing, and it was having mentors and bosses like that in my career made all of the difference. I'll just tell you one little thing about figuring out your path along the way. I loved being White House correspondent. I've always loved politics. My father was in politics. It's sort of in my blood. And I remember doing pretty well in that job and really feeling like I owned it, and then getting a call from my boss, Neil Shapiro, who was president of NBC News at the time, and he offered me the Weekend Today Show, hosting the Weekend Today Show. And I didn't want to do it. And I was telling him I didn't want to do it. I love what I'm doing now. I don't want to do this. And he was like, this is a big promotion. You get that, right? And I was like, it's a promotion to leave the White House to go to a cooking segment? It is. He's like, yeah, in television, actually it is. And I struggled with that, but obviously I took the job, and you couldn't say no to it. But I look back on it now as one of those moments where, when you're on your path and you're doing something you love, don't get distracted by something because you're told it's a promotion, and that can happen sometimes when maybe you get offered more money or something. That was leaving the White House, and I got back to it when I was at CNN and I was doing politics again, but it took me a long time to learn to do that job. I mean, I was literally, people would come on and I was like grilling the cooking lady, like she was Ari Fleischer, the White House press secretary. It just like wasn't my thing. And I think I got better at it because I had a good co-host, and Lester Holt was my co-host, and he was was like, follow my lead. And I got better at it every time, but it wasn't my thing. And I had my thing, and I got back to it later, but it's, you find that along your life. You get on and off your path, and you know when you're on it, and then you realize when you've gotten off it, and you've got to try to get back to that thing that gets you excited.
Your passion.
Exactly.
Absolutely, your passion. How many journalism majors do we have in the room? So remember what Campbell said about when she graduated and she sent out 200, and she heard back from one station that wanted her. So you got to work that system. You can't be discouraged about it. You got to be out there all the time. What little bit of advice would you give them now while they're still in school to do to get a little ahead of that curve?
Well, I mean, what's so exciting to me now, looking at you guys, is that it's such a, don't do anything I did. The rules have completely changed. And it's the Wild West right now in media. There are no rules. All the traditional media companies are kind of imploding. They're cutting back, they're laying people off. Where the growth and where the excitement is in digital media, which means, we were talking about it earlier in your interview, you have to be able to sort of do everything. I was a TV person. I love to write, fortunately, so I found sort of a new career writing afterwards, but you have to be able to write, you have to be able to do video, you have to be able to really understand social media and access all the tools of social media that are at your disposal to get your stories out there. But it's also, my generation doesn't understand as intuitively how to do this stuff the way that you guys do because you grew up on it. So in a way, you don't have to wait your turn the same way that I did necessarily and pay your dues. If you are creative and entrepreneurial, you can do incredible things without having to go to work for one of the traditional big media companies. I have found that starting this nonprofit news site called The 74, we have been able to do some really extraordinary things just because we're hustlers. It's everybody who works for me is a young journalist, and we decided we're just gonna, go all out on this one single issue. And we hosted in, Linda came in August, a forum for presidential candidates. We did one for Republicans, we've been trying to do one for Democrats, on education, to have them all do one-on-one interviews for about 45 minutes, just about K-12 public education. And we got six of the candidates to come to our New Hampshire forum, and I just, at the debate a couple of days ago, I interviewed Marco Rubio and Ben Carson on the issue. But at the forum, we had 100 other news outlets covering our forum. The New York Times, Washington Post, NBC News was there. And a friend of mine, who's now one of the editorial people at NBC, called me afterwards, and she was like, "Oh, that was great. Why didn't we do that?" And I said, "Why didn't you do that?" They just didn't think of it, or they were so focused on sort of the obvious that they didn't think, wow, if we held a forum on a single issue, we could get all these guys there. And because we were scrappy and just trying to make a name for ourselves, and fortunately, some of them said yes, we were able to pull off something pretty big and really news-making, not just news covering, but news-making with our scrappy little nonprofit news site that no one had ever heard of that had been in existence for 2 months. So I'm really proud of that, and that's what I say to you, like, it's go for it. It's such an incredible opportunity right now, and I would take a job in a heartbeat at, BuzzFeed before I would the New York Times. I mean, in a heartbeat. It's way more exciting, and they are on the cutting edge of how we're communicating, and that is the future. There's no putting the genie back in the bottle.
When I was on campaigning, and I was an editorial review board, and I was asked one day, what is one of the toughest things when you're campaigning? And I said, well, along these lines and to your point, I said, at any given moment of any given day, given a 24-hour news cycle by covering everywhere today, I'd be expected as a candidate to be informed about every issue that was happening. And something could have happened in the world while I was in that room with the editorial review board, and if I came out, one of the journalists would come up to me and say, well, what's going on with so-and-so, so-and-so, did you hear about that? And it's like, if you say, wow, I haven't heard about that yet, you're just a dummy and not informed. And you're expected to have an opinion like that and not have any opportunity to be contemplated. So that is challenging for those who really are campaigning or out with a message that they're trying to speak to, but that just shows you the power of instant news everywhere and how you have such an opportunity, to lock into that. So Campbell, today, this series is really about, it's about women's leadership, but I wanted a title for the series that was kind of a little bit provocative. So our title is Women Can Have It All.
And really?
Women can have it all. So, obviously that is it is meant to be provocative and evocative. And to you, what does that mean? That women can have it all.
It means, I feel closer to that today than I certainly ever have. I'm certainly not the first person to say this, but I do think it's true that women can have it all, just not all at one time. I read Lean In, obviously. I appreciate Cheryl's point about our need at certain points of our career to really demand what we deserve, and I'll give you an example of that. When I was White House correspondent, I was asked to be White House correspondent, there were always two NBC correspondents, and the ones who preceded me were Claire Shipman and David Bloom, who passed away, the great David Bloom. And when I was offered the job after the Bush campaign, I was offered it with David Gregory. And traditionally, when Claire and David had had the job previously, they had alternated. One would do Today Show 1 week, and one would do the nightly news show, and then they would switch each week. And it was, you know, considered sort of in the network world that the better job was nightly news. Everybody wanted to be on the nightly news with Tom Brokaw. The Today Show was kind of the second tier job. So when they offered me the job, they offered David Gregory the senior job of nightly news, and they offered me the Today Show. And I was going to be the second tier person. And Claire Shipman said to me, "Don't take it. Demand alternating weeks." I was like, "Are you kidding me? Like, I can't even believe I'm here. I'm just so happy that like they're offering me a job. I can't say no." And she was like, "Listen to me. This is really important. Demand alternating weeks. You worked as hard as he did on this campaign. You have to ask for that." And I did. And my agent even told me I was crazy. And I was so scared when I asked them for that. And they said yes. Actually, they put me on probation. They said yes, but I was on probation for like 2 months. And if I hadn't demanded it, it wouldn't have happened. So that's what Lean In to me is about. And it's really important at those moments at our lives that we have the confidence to ask for those things and demand equal treatment. One second, and I know you're going to follow up on, but I will tell you that on the having it all piece, something changes when you have children. You know, it just does. Somebody, when I had my first child, I got a note from someone that said, "The world is divided into people who have kids and people who don't. Welcome to the other side." And I was like, "Oh, I know what that means." And it will have a huge impact on how you think about your life and how it works, and there's just no avoiding that. And it's different for women than it is for men. It just is, and it always will be until the day that men can have babies and be pregnant and breastfeed. And that's not gonna happen.
So that's probably way up.
Well, we'll see.
But was there,
I'm sorry. Well, I'll just give you one moment where I felt it was time to lean out. And that was, right after my first child was born, I was asked, literally they called me a week after he was born. This is when I was at CNN, and they asked me to moderate one of the presidential debates. It was when Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton were in the running, one of the Democratic primary debates. And it was gonna happen when my child was 7 or 8 weeks old. And what was I gonna do? You can't say no. But I was breastfeeding. And I had this crazy hippie mom who was a light leche league mother who basically ingrained in my brain that you had to breastfeed and formula kills children and all these things that I later found out weren't true. But so I was determined to go moderate this presidential debate while breastfeeding. So I had this big plan that I would get to the debate, I would pump, and I would freeze my milk and FedEx it overnight back to my husband so that the baby didn't have to have formula while I was gone. This is my genius idea. So literally, there was this young journalism student, the debate was happening at the University of Texas in Austin. This young journalism student had been assigned to help me out, get ready for the debate. And she comes running up to me to say at one point, what can I do to help? And I know she had like these visions of like learning what it was like to be a news anchor. And I was like, "Take these two bags of breast milk back to my hotel and stick them in the freezer, please." It's like not really what she had in mind. But I had a moment where right before we went on the air, because I was going to be on the air for 3 hours and I couldn't take a break, so I had to pump right before I went on. And I was sitting in a closet on the floor in the back of the auditorium where the debate was taking place. There was Secret Service outside of the door because Obama and Mrs. Clinton were back there getting ready. And it was the only place I could get privacy and a plug. And I was sitting there on the floor, like going through my notes, like trying to get ready, trying to stay focused, pumping, breast milk's flying everywhere. It was like And then, of course, when I'm on the air, I'm thinking one thing, which if there's any mother who's in this room knows who's breastfed, you're just like, please, please, God, don't let my boobs explode. I'm sorry, I shouldn't be saying that in school, but that's in my brain as I'm moderating this debate, right? So I am supposed to be thinking about my questions and my follow-ups and being on it, and that is what is in my brain.
So at that moment, were you saying women can have it all?
No, I was saying this is ridiculous. You know, it just, that crystallized it for me. And I stayed there. I mean, I didn't quit my job then, but it was over. It was when my second child, I had my second child. And I'll give you another moment. I got pregnant late in life, and it took me a long time to get pregnant with my first. And so my husband and I were like, oh, we got to start right away because, you know, it'll take a few years. And of course, we got pregnant immediately. So my kids are 14 months apart. Yes. So it was, I had told my bosses at CNN hired me when I was not pregnant. And when we were negotiating the contract, I got pregnant and I had to tell them. And I said to them, like, you know, look, I just want you to know, you're bringing me in to start this new show. I am 4 months pregnant and you need to know that. If you want to rip up the contract, I totally understand. I didn't need to say that, but I did. They said, no, of course, we're happy you're a new mom. We'll delay the start of the show while you have your baby, and then you'll come back, and it'll be full swing. So I was really stressed about telling my boss, like, right as I had come back to work, that I was pregnant again. And I didn't tell him for a while because I couldn't figure out how. Did you guys see that movie Knocked Up?
Yes.
Right, she's trying to keep in the secret that she's pregnant. So that was me. And I was, like, getting fatter and fatter. And I couldn't figure out how to tell him. I didn't want to tell him, so I was like hiding. I was wearing these big jackets. I secretly told the director of the show, so she was like shooting me higher and higher. The desk was coming up and up. And finally, it was like, I've got to tell him. So I invited him to lunch. And I'm not going to say who this is, but I invited him to lunch, and we are, we're eating lunch, and he starts talking to me about his personal trainer. And like how great he is, and you know, and if, you know, if I want his number, like, he's happy to give me his number. And it's like on and on about, and I'm like, it was that scene in Knocked Up where her boss is like, he can't tell her she has to lose weight, so he just tells her, it'd be great if you could just tighten, because he can't use the words lose weight. And she's like, tighten? Like, what do you mean? Like, shrink? And that's what I was being told. It was very clear to me, and I was like, I'm pregnant again. So look, they rolled with it, but it is like, you know, to pretend that these issues don't come up in the workplace, they do. They do. And I think we're evolving and getting better as a society about how we think about it, and employers are obviously being more attuned to how to deal with it as they appreciate the skill sets that women and the importance of women being in the workplace and keeping their jobs and making it easier for us to, you know, have it all to the extent we can, but these are real pressures. And at a certain point, I hosted a show that was from 8 to 9 at night, and I never saw my kids, and it just was a struggle for me to not be there, and it felt like the right thing to do. So I left about three years ago.
But you have a very supportive husband at home.
Yes. Yes. I'm very lucky for that. Yes. Yes.
And tell us a story about how you met Dan. Dan Senor.
Yes. So I met Dan in Baghdad. I was right at that age where I was feeling like work had taken over my life. I was traveling so much. I was never going to meet anyone. Matt Lauer had set me up on a blind date. I was supposed to go on a blind date, and he was like, this is the one. I know this is the one. This is the guy. And I was supposed to be that Saturday night, and I had to call the guy and break the date because NBC called me and said, we need you to go to Baghdad. You got to leave Saturday morning. I was like, but I have a date with the one. So I had to cancel it, and then on this trip, I actually met the one. So, yeah.
See, that was, so you do have to take those adventurous assignments from time to time, because you never know when the one might be there,
right,
on either side. So when your children came along, you know, you were now a member of the haves or the have-nots. You have children.
Yeah.
How did that change kind of your work-life balance and in terms of, you know, what was taking precedence for you and how were you kind of balancing? You spoke a little bit about
yeah.
that in a little bit more detail.
You know, it depends on how much money you make. I mean, I was really lucky. I was in a job that allowed me to afford to have great health. And I was still struggling. So how you do this when you're struggling financially is, you know, an enormous challenge for women. And I'm very appreciative of the resources that I have that gave me a lot of freedom that most people don't have, obviously. But even then, I knew I was missing out on something I didn't want to miss out on. My kids were being raised by nannies, and my older one would cry out for this nanny. Her name is Autumn. And every night, when she'd wake up in the middle of the night, he'd cry for Autumn, like, never mommy, it was always Autumn, and that was, like, killing me. And when I did finally quit, I, in fairness, at CNN, it was a rough, the show was struggling. CNN was going through some real ratings troubles. I was in a time slot against Bill O'Reilly and Keith Olbermann when he was at NBC, and I was under a lot of pressure from CNN to sort of turn my show into more of that kind of aggressive shout fest news, which wasn't who I was, and it's not something I felt comfortable with, and it just wasn't working. So I fired myself, which I think was smart, because you in television will see the writing on the wall. And if I had stayed for a couple of years, I wanted to get out on my terms. So I fired myself, and then I fired the nanny. Because I had to reestablish this bond with my kids, right, when I came home. And I remember, and she understood, she was a great girl, but the day she walked out the door, my kid was banging against the door as she walked out and closed the door behind her, screaming, Autumn, don't leave me, Autumn, don't leave me, he's bawling. And I'm sitting there thinking, this is terrible. Like, I'm never going to be able to establish this maternal bond with my son, and he's always going to be connected to her for the rest of his life. And I'm like really dying inside. And then I said, hey, do you want to go get ice cream? And he nodded his little head, and he never mentioned her name again. So, like, we put all this pressure on ourselves, you know, we convince ourselves that, you know, we're failing as mothers, and it really just takes a little ice cream.
Yeah, well, how do you think we can encourage more women to, A, want to start their own businesses? Actually, point of fact, more women are starting businesses than men and having higher success rates. But, you know, we're 51% of the population. We vote in larger numbers than men do, and yet in the C-suite, on corporate boards, or even in Congress, we're so far the minority. What kind of message would you give to encourage, women to seek more of these kinds of roles?
Well, I will say, I think that's the key to it. I think it will, if you can be more entrepreneurial, you will find that success far faster than you will in a corporate environment. I find, we're gonna get there, where the more corporate environment is more attuned to what's going on, but it's gonna take longer. And since I left TV, I've started a nonprofit news site and another nonprofit that's working on litigation. And I now have basically all in about 19 people working for me. And I'm my own boss. And it's not working for me. I mean, I have partners. I co-founded the site with another woman, and I could not do this. I think women are really great at teamwork, especially, and we're really good at collaborative efforts, and so I have a great team of a lot of women on our staff that I surround myself with, but we have an incredible maternity leave policy. It is 8 months off and 6 months paid, and I don't know, you know, I'm a nonprofit. But I believe in this stuff, and I think we have to stand behind it. And I also work my own hours. I mean, I do a lot of work when the kids go to bed. You know what that's like. You know, when you can be your own boss, and create sort of the life that you want. You build it around the things that are important to you. And in sort of the new digital media environment, like for the 74, from Christmas to New Year's, those 2 weeks, we're all going to work from wherever we are. And we can do that now. I mean, technology is giving us all these incredible tools that you all will have that we didn't. And everybody on my staff is going to get to go be with their families for 2 weeks without taking a single vacation day, unless they want to, because we can all work from wherever we are. And I think trying to find places that give you that kind of flexibility to do what you want to do that makes you happy, but also to live your life. Because at the end of the day, the older you get, what you will find is nothing matters more than your friends and family and maintaining those relationships. And, you know, I mean, I'll just give you one more example about like true friendship and family. When I was on TV for a long time, and when you're part of that world, you will have a lot of TV friends, right? A lot of people who are in media or who are in, you know this, when you're in politics or something, you have people who are in your life because you're on television or in that role. And I remember a friend of mine from CNN who was in DC who quit her job. I asked her how it was going a couple of weeks after she quit, and she said, people don't even talk to me anymore. I told people I'm not on TV, and she's like, I gotta move. I can't be in this town because like suddenly I don't exist. I was like, ugh, that's so awful. But I got a little bit of that when I left TV from people that suddenly like I don't exist. And I remember as I was telling people I was quitting, I am on the board of the preschool where my kids go, the Jewish Community Center in downtown Manhattan. And I've met a lot of my close friends through that when, you know, other mothers of kids my age. And I remember my friend Aaron, as I was telling people, I was getting like all this negative reaction that I was quitting. And I told my friend Aaron I'm quitting, and she was like, that's great! You're gonna be on the benefit committee, and we can go out, and I'll do all these things. I was like, oh, I don't wanna be on the benefit committee ever, but I'm so glad you said that. It was like so nice to hear. And I was like, she's one of my closest friends in the world now. And it was like recognizing those friendships and how my husband didn't care, and you find out who your close friends are and the people in your life that really matter, and you appreciate how important it is to nurture those relationships and take the time to be there for those people. And I, you know, when you set your priorities, those are my priorities now more than anything. And I, you know, it took me a while to really appreciate how, you know, important those friendships were, because it was easy when you're climbing the career ladder at NBC or wherever else to be like, oh, I got to go here, I got to do this, I'm going to get this hot job, and I can't be there. And you miss all. I mean, I worked every Christmas, every Thanksgiving, and now I'm glad I did it. So you know, you can't have regrets, obviously, but I know how important the family time is and those relationships. And you know, the friendships you're having now, stay in touch with these people. It will mean a lot to you later.
Well, you've sort of come all the way from reporter, journalist, and some now call you activist. Talk a little bit about that. Why are you being called an activist? And how does the 74 fit into that?
So, when I left CNN, I was trying to keep a toe in the water, and I started doing some writing, op-eds for the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal. And I was looking for story ideas. And at the time, my kids were starting to be school age, and I was thinking a lot about where they were gonna go to school. And I think one of the eye-opening things for me was actually a hair and makeup artist at NBC News. This is the first time I woke up to this, who didn't make a lot of money. She was a close friend of mine. She used to do my hair for when I was on the Today Show. And she had she was a single mom, she had a little boy, and she was always struggling financially. And he became school age, and she was trying to figure out where he was gonna go to school, and she found out the school she was zoned for in her neighborhood in New York was a failing school. I mean, was getting Fs, was terrible. And she toured it, and she was like, I can't send my kid here. But she couldn't afford private school. There was a Catholic school nearby. She didn't make enough money to send him there. She had applied to charter schools. It was the first time I ever heard of a charter school. I didn't know what it was. These are public schools that don't operate under union rules. And she was on a wait list. And she didn't know what she was going to do. And she was just desperate and panicked about it. We talked about it all the time. And she came into work one day, and she's like, I figured out the school problem. I said, what? What did you do? And she said, well, you know, Marie. And Marie was this woman who lived in this big fancy house on the Upper East Side in a gorgeous neighborhood that had one of the best public schools in New York City. She said, I've cut a deal with Marie. I'm going to do her hair for the rest of her life for free, but she'll let me use her address. Now, that's illegal. And I said to her, that's illegal. She's like, what would you do if it was your kid? And I was like, oh my God, I'd do anything. I'd do anything. So, you know, this is how our public school system works. This is how education works. If you have money in this country, you can give your children the best education imaginable. If you don't, you better hope that wherever you live has a good public school, because your future is determined largely based on your zip code. And I didn't appreciate it till I had kids, and I had been lucky enough to have this career. I could afford to send them to whatever kind of school I wanted. And here's my friend Christine, who is so desperate to give the same thing to her kid, who loves her kid as much as I love mine, who wants the same things for her child, and she has to break the law in order to send him to a decent school. That's crazy. And then, as I was looking for things to write about, I came across a story in the New York Daily News that I thought was made up because it was so crazy. It listed these 14 teachers who had been found guilty of sexual misconduct with kids who had kept their jobs. And I thought, this can't be true. And in New York and in California and a number of other states, there are laws on the books that give these extraordinary protections to teachers that make it, in some cases, almost impossible to remove a teacher who's even engaged in abuse. And I thought it was so crazy. I thought if anybody knew this, there would be an outrage of, you know, people would go crazy and march on Albany. So I wrote a piece about it, and people did go crazy. They started attacking me for writing a piece about this law. The teachers' unions got very angry and started writing, you know, protests about what I had said in the piece. And that sort of piqued my curiosity as a journalist, because there was such a disproportionate reaction to what I had said. People were so angry at me for pointing out, this is a law we have, and here's how it impacts people, and this is crazy. And so I got more and more involved and in trying to look at sort of how our laws work and understanding the politics of it and the influence that the unions have in Albany and how it makes it very hard, almost impossible, to change these laws. And so I'm helping some parents in New York who brought a lawsuit that are challenging these laws on constitutional grounds, saying that they're there and they deny their kids their constitutional right to a decent education. And I'll be honest, the lawsuit's been very controversial. I get, you know, people showing up to protest pretty much anywhere I go now. I'm so glad there aren't any here. But I did the Colbert show, and there were 100 protesters outside. He said it was the first time they had ever had protesters there. But there, you know, there are people who don't want things to change, and the world is changing. And we currently in this country, 2 out of 3 eighth graders cannot read or do math at proficiency. 2 out of 3. We are in real trouble if we don't address this problem. Real trouble. And if you look at where we rank compared to other countries, I think in the latest numbers we were 24th in math and 27th in English and reading, behind Poland. But I mean, this is the United States of America. That's not sustainable. So I sort of got more and more involved the more I read and the more I learned. And being a journalist, I still believe in the power of media and the power of storytelling to raise people's awareness and ultimately try to get them to do something. So that's what led to the founding of the 74, which we worked on for about a year, but it was intended to call attention to the inequality that exists in our system that affects all of us, frankly, because as a country, we will not remain competitive if we have two-thirds of our kids who aren't able to go through college. So
Well, congratulations and thank you for doing that. And you said it right at the beginning when I asked about, you know, women can have it all and did you believe it? And you said, well, you're close. So what's lacking now? I mean, for those sitting listening, they might say, well, geez, you've had a wonderful career. You've got two beautiful sons. You're able to do a lot of things with them. I am a very supportive husband. You're still involved in something that you want to do. What's missing for Campbell Brown that says you don't have it all?
I'm just restless. I mean, that's why I went into journalism, so they probably know. It's a job for restless people, right? So I don't think I'm ever going to feel like, okay, this is it. I can relax. It's not my nature. But I do think, and it's the nature of life. You know, I wouldn't have, as I said before, I wouldn't have been able in my 30s to do the things I'm doing today because I wouldn't have had the confidence to, you know, to involve myself in a political fight or to speak out or to know, you know, have the confidence to really say, look, I was trained in the Tim Russert school of, you know, presenting both sides of an issue and trying to appear balanced, but Tim also never taught me to be a stenographer, you know, and if one side is right and one side is wrong, and you're a journalist, your job is to tell the truth, you need to be able to point out that one side is right and one side is wrong. And it, you know, I, in my early 30s, I wouldn't have felt the confidence to do that. Today, I feel very confident about speaking out about these things. And the most fulfilling thing I'm doing right now, honestly, is mentoring the 12 journalists we have on our staff who are, you know, I watch them who have a voice and have a view. And, you know, they're like, oh, but I can't say that. I'm like, why not? Is it true? Well, yeah, then say it. If it's true, then say it. We can back it up. We have the facts and say it. And really watching them find their voice and do something that's impactful and meaningful. This is, as I said before, I keep saying it, it's such an incredible time. I know you hear all these stories about media where people are so depressed, media's, you know, losing money, it's all, you know, it's such a terrible time to be in journalism. I believe the opposite. It has never been a more exciting time. It's just an entirely different business. And you can do things that are really impactful and really meaningful. It's just gonna be in a different way. And again, if you're open to it, it's an exciting moment. And I would just say, use your creativity. Be confident, take risks, the most important thing in the world, you know this.
Yeah.
Take a risk and be willing to fail. You know, failure, those moments, like leaving CNN, when my show wasn't working, you know, that was a failure. And recognizing it, and in that moment, finding out who my real friends are, finding out what really matters, that is the, you know, those are the moments that give you the confidence to then take the next step and do the next thing that's going to be even better and more satisfying and hopefully more fulfilling.
Thank you. And I know there have to be questions out here in the audience, maybe from some of the aspiring journalists that we have here. You could start today by by asking a question of one of the foremost journalists in the country.
We have a mic for you if you need it. Otherwise, just yell it out.
Yes?
Hi, I'm Tom Miller. I work with the Mercy Learning Center in Bridgeport. So it's a whole different spectrum of achievement we're talking about. Their theme is teach a woman, teach a family. And it's for 96% of the students are below the poverty level. Most of them well past the normal K-12. Looking at K-12, short of a Katrina-like thing, it ties to your Emmy and all. After Katrina, virtually all the people in the New Orleans educational system were let go, and they basically started over from scratch, and they had 85% charter schools.
Right.
But do you feel a little like tilting at windmills to do it in a place like New York?
Yes. The legal avenue is, I think, the most interesting and the most excited people have been in a long time, because they've tried to do this at the legislative level so many times and failed.
Right.
But we, the judge in our case, we are suing the state of New York, the city of New York, and the teachers' unions intervened to become a defendant in this case. And we, the judge in this case, they filed a motion to have our case thrown out. They argued we didn't have a right to bring it in the first place. And the judge sided with us. This was considered a big victory. And he said, I will not stop parents and students at the courthouse steps who have a legitimate case to bring. This should be heard in his ruling. And that's really powerful. And that has scared a lot of people in Albany who see, you know, what could happen if a judge says these laws are unconstitutional. It will be a huge victory. The same thing happened in California, which is what inspired the New York case. They brought a similar legal case and won. And it has, you know, brought more attention to some of these problems and really made it a big issue there. To me, that's as much a victory as anything else. You know, there are a lot, I didn't know about these laws until I got involved in all this. So, you know, as the news media focuses on the legal case, more and more people become aware. The pressure starts to build. Here's the thing that makes me feel most hopeful that I'm not tilting at windmills. Things are going to change. Technology is advancing so rapidly. You have, you know, almost everyone has a smartphone, and depending on, even if you are at the poverty level, you are going to get over the next 5 to 10 years access to technology that is going to transform the classroom. I don't care how much the status quo is holding on. It's going to. We can't, you know, just think about how all other aspects of our lives have changed, you know, with technology. You're banking on your phone. You're doing, you know, my kids have never even seen a commercial except when they watch football. You know, they don't, it's like everything's changed except the way we go to school. You know, it's exactly like the way my grandparents went to school. They sit in a class at a desk with a teacher in front of the classroom. So that's ridiculous. The technology currently exists that will, you know, allow lesson plans to be tailored to the way a child learns, that can, you know, that can keep track of all of the data around what the kid is learning each day, so we don't have to do all this testing that makes people crazy. All of that technology is there. It's just very hard to get it into the classroom because of these massive bureaucracies, and the unions are against a lot of it. That you can't stop it. We've seen how technology is, you know, even if you want to stop it, you can't. It's come into our lives in so many other ways. That's inevitable to me. So I'm just trying to create the environment that allows that change to come faster, that we can modernize and innovate a little faster, that we're sort of breaking down some of the barriers as much as we can. But it's coming. That's why I feel hopeful.
Yeah.
You talked a little bit about...
Hold the mic right up to you now.
Right. You talked a little bit about Lean In. Awesome. Sheryl Sandberg's book. She said that women also often pass on opportunities because of family obligations before they even have families. Did you find yourself struggling with that at any point in your career?
I didn't pass on them. But I remember having conversations. I was pregnant when I was at NBC, when I was changing from NBC to CNN. And I remember a conversation with one of my bosses at NBC who had said, you know, they were trying to convince me not to leave. And they said, this is your home. Like, you're pregnant, you can dial way back here and no one's gonna care. You go into a new one and then you dial back up when your kids get a little older. You can have that kind of life here. If you go to CNN, it's a whole new ballgame. You're gonna have your own show. It's gonna be too intense. You're not gonna be able to dial it down and dial back up. It was another woman I'd worked closely with. And, you know, in retrospect, I think she had a point, is that if you are, that's what I think I was talking about a little bit when I said, you know, starting your own business, be in an environment where you have more control. And I think what she was trying to tell me was you have a lot of control here because you've been here for so long that you can have more say over your life, and you'll appreciate it when you have kids how important that is. In retrospect, like I don't think had I not done CNN, it wouldn't have led me to, like, I love the path I'm on, so I feel like every decision was the right one for that reason. But I do appreciate that piece of advice, which is if you are in an environment, work environment that allows you, you know, you're going to need time off, that gives you that kind of time off so you can take it, whether it's a baby or a, you know, a parent who needs to be cared for. You want to find a place to work that's a place you like, that respects you and recognizes that we all have lives and that our lives are important to making us happy employees. You know, I've always quibbled a little bit with Lean In because those things are easy to say when you have money. And, you know, it's easy to make those choices when you have a support system that, you know, or the financial means to create a support system. It's a lot harder to say that to a woman who is just trying to make ends meet and, you know, doesn't have the kind of influence in her workplace that she can say, you know. So it's, I love Lean In and respect Cheryl's views on a lot of things, but it's a book that's meant for a very narrow audience, I feel like. Whereas where most of our country is not in a position to make those kind of choices.
You know, maybe I have time for one more question. Yes, but wait for the mic if you would, so that everyone in the room can hear. Just here.
Hi, so most of us are in jobs.
Could you just say what your name is?
My name's Natalie Chifari. So most of us are in Joe Castro's TV magazine class, you know, where we learn how to be reporters and write, and it's fantastic. But as
you're learning from the best.
Oh, absolutely. As, you know, young journalists, when we're put in positions, you know, with internships and jobs and really trying to make it out there, you know. You know, you possibly might have to work Thanksgiving, Christmas, you know, give up a lot of your time. Like, you know, do you suggest we take those risks and we just really give it our all during college?
Absolutely. You know? You don't have any kids?
This is really
young. No, this is the time to work during Thanksgiving. The parents will forgive you. Your kids won't. you know, this is, yes, I would say more than anything, take all the internships you can. I mean, I was doing three unpaid internships, and I had a one paid job that I was doing part-time with these unpaid internships that had nothing to do with TV. And that was supporting my TV habit, which was paying me nothing. But I loved it. And look, I ended up being very successful because I pursued the thing I loved. And I do believe that, you know, make the decision about, you know, what you're gonna do with your life based on what your passion is, because it will lead to success. I totally believe that. But the internships, doing them now, is critical. You know, forget about summer playtime. If you want this, you gotta go for it. And do the internships in the summer or during the year if you can. And yeah, your vacations, all of that, this is, I'm talking about later in life. You have no kids, go for it. This is the time to work like crazy. If you have big dreams and you want to accomplish something, this is the moment in your life. When you have children and you're trying to raise a family and you're trying to juggle many more balls in the air than you are now, then it gets trickier. But enjoy this and go. I mean, I love my kids and I love my husband, but I loved being single and being on the campaign trail. And I mean, I lived when I covered the Bush campaign in 2000, I only got that job. I remember there were two other reporters more senior to me who wanted that job, which was being the number two to David Gregory on the campaign, to be on the campaign bus. And I didn't think I was going to get it because I had just started. And I went into the boss's office, Jeff Zucker, who was head of Today Show, and I said, if you give me this job, I will get on that bus and I will not come home until election day. Because what did I have to lose? I didn't care. I didn't have a boyfriend. I didn't have any kids. I went, and he said, all right. You know, the other ones had, you know, demands. I had no demands. I raised my hand and said, I will work harder than anybody else that you put in that job. And so I got it, and I did. I didn't come home, and I had a great time. Phenomenal year. So this is the time. Go for it. It matters, throwing yourself all in.
I had said one more question, but I'm going to take one more here.
Karen Douglas, and I would like to know, after your children are grown, would you consider going back to TV?
is TV still going to be around? I'm not sure. I don't know what it's going to look like. I think I will probably always do something that's related to media, but I don't want to go back and do what I've already done. That would be boring. I want to try something new. I love what I'm doing now because it's all new. I'm figuring out the digital world like everybody else is, and I get to, you know, mentor these young people about the journalism piece, which never really changes, about, you know, doing the right thing and being honest and truthful in your reporting. But I don't know what the world's going to look like in 10 years. You know, are we all going to be, you know, answering to robots? I mean, I just heard a lecture a few weeks ago that basically said, yes, it's going to be a totally different world. So I am getting more back into my career as my kids have gotten older than I ever have been over these last couple of years, so that'll continue. I'm never going to be one to sort of hang out. I'm too restless.
I think we've gotten a really good overview today, and I think you hear, maybe a couple of you have been to a couple of other in the series, but we kind of hear a common theme. You know, can women have it all? Can anyone have it all? And the truth is that you may be able to have it all, but you may not be able to have it all at the same time, and everyone's definition of having it all is very different. But you have to take risks, and you have to be prepared to fail. Because if you've never failed, you've never taken a risk, and you're really not going to get ahead. So you have to take risks, you know, in order to succeed, and not be afraid, you know, to do that. And something else that you've heard from Campbell, not only was she influenced by good mentors, but she now also is enjoying being a mentor to the journalism students, interns, and employees that are working for her. So it's important for you students to find good mentors, and it's important for all of us to be mentors. And then that can help us all have great leadership. We can always strive then to have it all, for whatever that means to each of us. So Campbell, thank you so very, very much for being here.